So welcome to the lecture number 10 of the deep learning course. In this particular session, we are going to talk about neural network training, and we are going to see a method that is called the backpropagation. So when we were discussing about the history of the neural network, at that time I told you that what happens that when we create a neural network, you know that neural network creation is very important because only a single perceptron is going to act as a linear decision boundary only. So if you want to be more powerful, then you have to do something extra. And therefore you would be putting more neurons at a particular place, and then you develop the higher level understanding of those kind of lines, and then better features out of that using different kind of layers. But what happens that when you make those kind of layers, finding out the right parameter become a challenge, as you have seen that even using a single neuron perceptron, it was going to take a lot of time. So when the backpropagation method was not there, then it was very difficult to go ahead with the things. So maybe because of this reason only, we have seen that the people stopped talking about the neural network at some point of time. This algorithm came around 1986, and then this algorithm actually revolutionized once again the neural network thing, and people started thinking that, okay, now they can get something meaningful out of this. However, as I mentioned, I think in the last class also, that in that class also, that these kind of methods are actually not very new. The idea was there, and this is in the signal processing and other domain, people were using this. But specifically for training the neural network, this technique was used in around 1986, and that's why this is not a purely new thing, but good thing was only that the people have actually utilized over here, and therefore they were able to find out the right parameter. So we are going to see that does it mean, and what is the mathematical basis out of that into this particular session. So till this point, we know that what is our scenario situation. Our situation is this, that we have seen that a single perceptron has a problem because it has a limitation that it can only be a linear classifier. Most of the problem are nonlinear. So we want to make a neural network, and where we want to put multiple layers and build a better system out of that. Here also we had a problem that when you are going to use a perceptron, then perceptron, because of this thresholding, actually fluctuates its classification decision a lot. And this is the region because of which we were not able to train it to a best fit hypothesis, because we were not knowing that where to stop. So we have seen in the last class that instead of using this thresholding, we can utilize some kind of linear functions, some kind of non-linear functions, and at the place of activation, and then the output would be differentiable everywhere, and then we can find out what is the gradient, and based on that gradient we can find out that what is the appropriate parameter. So we are into this particular scenario that when you have an input feature vector x, I say that feature vector x, and you want to find out that what is the output of that particular thing with respect to a neural network that differently we have actually devised. So it is going to be the multiplication of weight matrix multiplied by x. So this equation is only talking about with respect to the one, but you can think that overall there is some weight and you are going to multiply with that x and finding out that what is the output. For one neuron, there should be activation function. We have seen that activation function could be many, and what are their properties. And in the last class, we have come up that if we use sigmoid, the function is this, that 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus y. So in this way, we can utilize this particular function. We have also seen that this function has an important property that that at the zero, the value is 0.5. At the minus infinity, it is 0. At the plus infinity, it is 1. So some kind of probability mechanism we can also associate with this. And we can think that it tells me that what is the probability of an item being in a particular class. Then comes the method that if you are going to make the various layers, then how can you find out the what are the parameter in between? Okay, let's assume that these are the layer. We want to find out that what are the weight values at this particular locations. So back propagation is an algorithm that learns weight for a fixed set of unit and interconnection. Means if you fix the network architecture, you say that in this particular layer there is the another hidden layer, another hidden layer, then output layer, and you say that here three neurons are there, two neurons are there, here three neurons are there, here three things are there. If you fix all these things, by this everything is got fixed, okay? Everything here, you know that they are fully connected, so they are going to be this kind of network architecture, and we want to find out that what is the value of weight over there. So our back propagation is going to do that. How it does it? It implies a gradient descent method. What is a gradient descent method? We know that gradient descent method means finding out the optimal parameter based on using the gradient. So let us once again quickly see that what is the error function that we had in terms of the neural network. So in the previous class we have developed an understanding that when the perceptron is not thresholded, instead there is some activation being applied, then ultimately we are going to get some values, and therefore you have to find out that what is the target and what is the output your system is going to give. If you want the output to be 1, your system should provide the output that should be very near to the target, possibly 1. If you want 0, your target, your value should be very near to the 0, possibly 0. So this is the target and this is the output. If you see the difference between these two, target minus output, this value should be 0 in both the cases. We want this. So we want to minimize this particular quantity for every data item, because how many data items we have, whatever data items we have, for each of the data items, we want this quantity to be minimized. So you know that the difference could be positive and negative. So to come up with the only a positive value, we say that target minus output square. So this is a general understanding that with the target minus output, what is the target and what is the output? You see the difference, take the square difference of this. And this you have to find out summation of what on all the data items that you have. Everybody is okay with that? You want to find out the summation for all the data items that you have. What is the target minus output square? Okay. Few minutes back, I have actually mentioned this and I have not highlighted this particular part. The time has come to highlight that particular thing. That let's assume that these are the layers. At the final layer, which I said that it is an output layer, there could be multiple neurons. Okay. Why multiple neurons? In the general setting, what happens that you can have the multiple neurons. Otherwise, what we think that any problem that we have, any classification problem we have, we can always convert it as a one versus rest. Okay. We tell that whether it is this or not. But if there are multiple classes, then another approach could be that you deploy a different kind of neurons, and each of those neurons are going to tell that what is the probability of this particular item being into this particular class. For example, MNIST database, we know that items are digits, so they can be 0, 1, 2, 3, dot, dot, 9, 9, 10 values are possible. So at the output level, you put how many neurons? You put 10 neurons. And when you are going to feed a particular image to the system, to the neural network, then you expect that these values, whatever the value that you are going to get, they are going to represent that what is the probability that this item is going to be 0? What is the probability that this item is going to be 1? What is the probability this item is going to be 9? So whatever neurons gives you the maximum value, you are going to utilize that particular value for the classification. So in this particular kind of setting where when I am going to feed one value over here and I am going to get multiple values over there, so here in this particular setting, what you expect? You expect that, let's assume that you are going to feed a value that is for example, let's assume that you feed the value 7. So out of these, the neuron corresponding to 7 should provide you what value? 1. It should provide you the value 1, and all others should provide what? They should provide 0. Okay, if they are providing 1, they are also, some of them are also providing 1, then it would not be a good thing. Okay, so into the general setting, if I just focus on one data point and want to find out that what is the error. So here in this particular setting, you can say that for all the outputs, for example, for all the outputs, what I wanted to tell that if you pick any of the things into output, any of the neuron from the output and find out the summation that what is the difference of this target minus output. For all these values, for every value, this value should be actually minimized. Only one, if you say that for the 7 it is 1, here also it is 1, then it is not a good thing. We expect that here should be 1, all other places should be 0. So we have to write this particular equation. Everybody, can you tell me that is there any difference that with this target minus output? Here, just for the sake of clarity, I can write that it is a kth target and kth output. Okay, for the kth one. Okay, for the kth neuron, I'm going to talk about. I'm talking about. Make sense? Clear? Okay. So this value, if this is the error with respect to a single item. So on the complete database, if I want to find out the what is the error, then I have to see that for all the items which are there into the database, I have to find out the summation. So this is the error function. So write the correct error function is this. Any problem on that? Any questions? So this error function is nothing more than this, that it is a general setting where I'm telling that on the output side, there are more than one neurons, they are deployed. Make sense? So this is the formula. And here, you know that why we put half for some mathematical convenience. So at later point of time, we can we don't come up with any unnecessary kind of variable. So we put half over here because if we want to minimize a quantity, half of that quantity would also be minimized when the value is minimized. Any question on this particular slide? All right. So now we are good to go. What is this? That we have defined that what is the error, and we have defined that what are my neurons, and now we want to find out the parameter. Okay, so in this particular session, whenever I am going to mean for initial most of the time when I am going to talk about that I am going to find out the value of parameter, then my setting is this, that I am going to have an input layer, I am going to have one hidden layer, and I am going to have one output layer. Okay, so when I'm in this particular discussion for some time, when I'm going to talk about, so there is one output layer, there is input layer, and there is one hidden layer. So if I say that I want to find out the parameters which are actually here, okay, so I would say that parameter with respect to the output layer. When I say that parameter with respect to the output layer, when I say that I want to find out what are the weights or parameter here, then I say that I'm going to find out the parameter related to the hidden layer. The same mechanism in which you are going to find out this particular value can be extended over here. So we are not right now. You discuss this later that how to find out for those. But right now I am going to find out the right parameter for this particular setting only. Here, as I told you, that you are going to provide the input to this particular input layer and you are going to get some output. Any problem? Any problem? Okay. So if you are okay with this, can anybody write yes? Then only I would proceed. Is everything is fine? No problem? Good. Excellent. So if you are okay with this, so I am going to talk a thing very loosely, that I say that if you want to find out the parameter, if you want to find out the parameter of here and here, the equation are not same, they are different equation. Okay, so how do we find out? Hello. Sorry. So what I wanted to tell you that that when you want to find out the parameter of here and parameter here, you are going to utilize a different kind of equations. What are those equations? How they come? We are definitely going to talk about this. This is the subject matter of today's class. But right now, I want to give you only the broad understanding. The how to come to that particular formula, we would discuss later. Let us see from the very high level perspective that if you want to find out, for example, the parameter over here or parameter here or here, ultimately what you have to do, you have to change the parameter. Means you start by some parameter, and with this parameter, you are going to add something. This is fine. Everybody understand that if you want to change the parameter, find out the right parameter, you start by one parameter and you are going to add something. What you have to add? This you have to add something. Okay, what is this? You know that there is a learning parameter, and with respect to that xji, because you know that into whenever you want to add something, this x is also being used. We are going to see that full detail, that how they come. And then there is something called delta j. Okay, this thing you are going to change. What is this eta? This is a learning parameter that is going to remain same. This is also coming from the database, but this delta j has a different, altogether different story. For the output units, this is for this, the formula is this output of k, 1 minus output of k, tk minus ok. Okay, and what is the for hidden layers? For the hidden layers, the formula is this. Output of the hidden layer, 1 minus output of the hidden layer, summation for all the k into the outputs, we are going to find out what is the wkh into delta k. This is for the hidden units. So how this come, we are going to see. Okay, don't focus on this right now. Only learn this particular part, that when you want to update the parameter here and when you want to update the parameter here, at those places you are going to use different kind of deltas, and using that delta you can find out how much you have to change. When you know how much you have to change, then you can update the parameter. That's all, very easy. Any questions on that right now? Don't go inside this formula, it would come. What I wanted to tell, that when you want to find out the right parameter of here, initially you can start by initializing the thing into the random. Then you have to change the parameter value so that they becomes optimized. How to change this? You are going to use this formula, how much you have to change. In this formula, there is a term called delta. This delta would be actually dependent whether you are going to change the things at the hidden level, hidden layer unit level, or the output unit level. Make sense? Any questions on that? Any problem? Everything is clear to you that we are going to talk with respect to a specialized networks, neural network circuit, and then that has only one hidden layer and one output layer. We want to find out the parameter. For finding out those parameter, we have to update the parameter in this particular setting, and you know that's very straightforward. All right, let us go inside and try to come up with this formula, that how they come, so that you can develop the better understanding of all these things. Few minutes back, into the previous slide, we have written that if you want to find out that what is the error with respect to the weights that you have, if some weight you fix, then what is the error? You have seen that for all the data items, for all the outputs, you are going to find out that what is the target minus output. Let me only focus for one data item, because one by one, you are going to use the data item. For every data item, you are going to update this thing until you converge. So let me only focus on the one data item. If you just focus on the one data item, we can remove this summation part, then it becomes easy to handle. For every data item, I am going to do that. So let me only focus for some time with respect to one data item only. So error with respect to a specific data item, when some weights are given to you, can be found out using this particular formula. Everybody is okay with that. Okay, when there is one data item, with this that data item, if we want to find out that what is the error with some specified weights, it is going to be this particular formula. Make sense? Okay. So you know that if gradient descent means what? That you find out that what is the gradient of this particular quantity. You find out what is the gradient of this particular quantity with respect to a weight, whatever weight you want to update. If you want to update, for example, weight ji, there is some weight. So you say that you find out what is the derivative of this particular quantity with respect to the ji, multiply with the eta and take minus of this quantity. This is how we update. Once again, anybody have the problem on this equation? Yes or no? If you want to find out the new value, you have to find out what is the derivative, this derivative with respect to that particular weight, and you go into the negative direction, because if you go into the positive direction, then error is going to increase. You want to decrease the error. That's why you go into the negative direction. That's it. That's simple formula. Great. So right now my problem is this, that my error is defined into this using this particular formula, and I want to find out this particular quantity. That's it. Okay. So before going to find in detail to find out this particular value, let me tell you some conventions that are needed to understand, because when we would be doing some derivation, whenever I'm mentioning something, what does it mean? So let me explain you that what is the convention I'm going to follow. So I have few questions for you. Okay. So this is a neural network circuit. So this is the input. This is the output. This is the first hidden layer. This is the second hidden layer. Okay. And just for the sake of generalization, I have put these things so that you understand this. Otherwise, few minutes back, I have talked about that there is no second hidden layer. Only one hidden layer is there and one output layer there, for which we are going to talk. Focus. All the neurons are given a number. This is the first neuron, second neuron, third neuron, fourth neuron, fifth neuron, sixth neuron, seventh neuron, eighth, nine, 10, 11, 12, and 13. Any problem? Yes or no? They have a specific name. Okay. When I am going to focus on a particular neuron, so this neuron would be getting the input from various places from the previous layer. Okay. This is the first input. This is the second input. This is the third input. This is the fourth input. First input is coming from the neuron 4. Forget about this 4. It is 1. This third input is coming from the neuron number 6. Forget about that. It is the third one. Third input. Okay. So means what? That this one is okay. So can you tell me, let me tell you that this particular connection has a name. What is the name? 9-1. For the ninth first one, this is the 9. Can you tell me? This is the 9-3. All right, correct. This is the 9-2 and this is the 9-4. Okay, these are the 9-4 connections. So these connections have two things. There is some weight W91, W92, W93, W94, because four inputs are there in this particular setting. They would also have something flowing inside this. What is that? X91, X92, X93. X94. Any problem? What is the summation that you are going to get over here? Turn by turn, you multiply these two things and add. Okay. Any questions on that? If I just focus on this particular item, ninth one. So this is the output that I'm going to get. This is the summation that I'm going to get. So what is, there is, again, I'm going to define something. What is net J? Net J means this summation. What is the net that you are going to get at this particular place? So net 9, what is this value? NET 9. So what is net 9? That what is the net 9? For the ninth one, what is the summation of the turn by turn multiplication of weight and flowing values? Make sense? What is the output at this particular place? You know that. You have to apply a sigmoid. Sigmoid of net j is equal to oj. So if you want to find out the output of 9, output of 9, what is the output of 9th unit is equal to sigmoid of net 9. Any questions on that? Any problem on that? Yes or no? Clear?
Yes, sir.
So I'm just telling the what is the convention. Okay. Okay. So these things are written over here. So this is, you know that this is 9-4. So 9-4 is highlighted. Okay. WJI, you understand. If I want to find out that what is this connection, this is weight of 12. This is the first one, second one, third, W3. Okay. Weight associated with that. WJI. When I say that net J, you have seen that this is the term by term multiplication of weight and input. What is the output? Output is a, when you apply sigmoid on net J, right now let's assume that you can apply other function also. You can apply tanh or whatever, softmax, whatever function you want to apply, you can apply over here. But right now we are applying what? Sigmoid. Tj, now output you understand. What is the target? What should be the right output at this particular place? That is the Tj. Tj is the right output at this particular place. But what is the output? Oj. And what is Oj? Oj is sigmoid of net J. So this square is a term that actually you want to minimize. So target, this is the target. What is outputs? That is a special set. Outputs is a special set that actually talks that who are the units at the output layer. Outputs means who are the units at the output layer. So who are those units? 12 and 13. These are the two units. So outputs mean 12 and 13. Last thing, that there is something called downstream J. If you want to see the downstream of J, one more definition. Down, downstream. Downstream. Downstream means who is receiving my output. Downstream of 9 are those things who are receiving the output of this 9. So they are right now 12 and 13. You know that, na? This goes to 12 and 13. So if I ask that what is the downstream of 5, they are 8, 9, 10 and 11. If I ask you what is downstream of 3, they are 4, 5, 6 and 7. Downstream of a particular unit is this. Who are the downstream of a particular unit? They are the ones who are immediately receiving the output of that particular unit. So now we are ready to go into the mathematics and to understand, because when we would be doing some derivations, we would be writing some things. So based on these things, I'm going to write. Everybody is okay. No confusion. So a few minutes back, we were talking about that we actually, whenever we want to update, we want this quantity. Okay. So here, what is eta? Eta and minus, they are fixed things. Okay. Fixed numbers. So ultimately, our interest is to find out that what is the error with respect to a particular WJI. Now you understand what is WJI. Okay. For there are multiple units. WJI, pick any particular unit and find out that means there is a unit called jth unit. For the jth unit, ith input connection. Okay. You want to update the weight of that particular thing. Understand? So this is that you see that what is the error, total error, and you want to actually minimize that. Okay. So you understand that we have the interest into finding out this particular quantity, and ED upon WJI, you can use the chain rule to write that ED upon net J and net J upon WJI. Just for the sake of solving this particular problem, we have applied a chain rule over here. What is net J? Net J, you know that. Net J is equal to WJ1 XJ1 plus WJ2 XJ2 dot dot dot. This value. WJI XJI plus dot dot dot. Net J is this is the formula of net J. And if you differentiate it with respect to what? WJI. So what would happen? WJI, this term would only this particular term, you can find out the derivative. All other things become zero because there is no WJI. They become zero. And here also, because this is a derivative with respect to WJI, so in differentiation of WJI becomes one. So what remains? The only thing remains is that this output part, that xji, this only remains. So you know that what is this thing. So we have solved one puzzle and we can find out that it is xji. Now we are interested to find out what is the value of this quantity. Let us find out that what is error with respect to the net j. Error with respect to the net j, when we are going to find out this, we are going to find out with respect to two different scenarios. Few minutes back I told you that input layer, hidden layer and output layer. When I am going to find out the parameter at the output layer. So let us focus that I am going to find out the parameter at this particular place. Later we will see that how to find out this particular quantity for the hidden layer also. Okay. All right. So you understand this. We want to find out this particular quantity for the output unit. Okay. So ED upon net J, you can again write it ED upon OJ and OJ of net J. What is OJ? Output of that thing. For a particular unit, what is the summation? For a particular unit, what is the output? So I'm going to write the equation into this particular way. Okay, two parts. Let me focus on this particular part first, that what is the error with respect to the output. So error with respect to the output is going to be, let me write the formula. ED formula is what? Half of for summation of all the k items and this. So it is a very interesting thing that in this particular formula, summation for different k's would be there. So t1 minus o1 square plus t2 minus o2 square, like that, multiple terms would be there. But I am going to find out the output with respect to the jth one only. So they all become zero, only tj minus oj would survive for doing the differentiation. Okay, for finding out the differential. And if you, so this half, you can take it out and then apply this differential on this particular quantity only. Okay, on this particular quantity only. So what would be the differentiation? You know that when you differentiate with respect to Tg, it becomes 2 into Tj minus Oj, and then D upon Dx of Oj becomes minus 1. Okay, so this is what the differentiation is. So here the first finding out, and this is the answer. Any problem in this? Because 2 that comes out is being cancelled by half. Yes, say yes or no.
Yes, sir.
Great. You can just type, okay, if you have any problem in speaking. Okay, everybody please type. I need many yes. Only Prabhu is telling. Where are other students? No problem. Yeah, please type yes. Okay. So this part is solved. We have find out that this value is minus of Tj minus Oj. Let me find out what is the next part. Oj upon net j. Oj upon net j is very important thing, because we know that what is the output. Output is a sigmoid of net j. So Oj upon net j, when we wanted to find out, it looks like that it is a derivative of sigmoid. Okay. So it is, what is this? That you want to del of sigmoid of net j upon del of net j. You know that you can sometimes change the variable. You can say that instead of net j, you put x over here. Here you also put x. So it becomes the derivative of sigmoid of x divided by partial derivative of x. Derivative of x, this quantity. Let us first find out that what is this value. Okay. So you know that this is the formula. Because sigmoid of x, this is the standard formula. Let me just put the right formula over there. So anybody can tell me that how to do that. 1 minus e to the power minus x to the power minus 1. So it is minus 1 plus 1 minus e to the power minus x to the power minus 2. I'm not going much detail. I think you can find out that then derivative of this particular term. When you find out the derivative, it is this becomes 0. This becomes e to the power minus of e to the power minus x. Then you can do some kind of jugglery, means adding 1 and subtracting 1. And by this terms can come down, and e to the power minus 1. And then when you adjust it into some way, you find out that the formula becomes this, that there is a sigmoid term and then 1 minus sigmoid term. This becomes, because these two things are same, into 1 minus sigmoid term. So this differentiation, everything is written over there. So you must be understanding that derivative of this thing comes out to be a sigmoid of x into 1 minus sigmoid of x. So in the previous class, I have just told you that this happens into this particular way. Now you can see that this is the answer. So, okay, So here, what is the x? Few minute back we have talked about that this was net j. So this quantity comes out to be sigmoid of net j 1 minus sigmoid of net j. We have solved everything. Okay, now we have everything. So what is net j? Sigmoid of net j. Sigmoid of net j is actually output. Sigmoid of net j is equal to output. So we can write this particular function as a oj 1 minus oj. All right, we wanted this quantity. This quantity is the multiplication of this and this, where the first part, this particular part has been solved over here. The second part has solved over here. Use those two things and write that what is here with respect to the net j. It comes out to be this equation. And into the previous equation, we have seen that. 1 minute, let me go and show you that. That here in this particular equation, this is the quantity that we have discovered. It is multiplied by xji. Okay. It is multiplied by xji. So, okay. So this part we have computed, but if you want to find out that how much I should change, then you also have to multiply with the xj, that as I told you. So this we have find out here. Very interestingly, this particular part, I am ignoring the sign over here, is called a delta j. I am going to call it as a delta j. Any problem in that? How much I have to change? Eta time, this quantity that comes over here, then xji that we have few minutes back talked about. This quantity, we know that what is this? You take it from here, you put it here because it was minus. E term was minus, so this minus goes away. Into this formula, you say that eta times tj minus oj, oj 1 minus oj, xji. So this is how much you have to change. And since you know that how much you have to change, you find out this quantity and then you apply into your formula and now you can update. For the hidden units, if you want to find out this particular quantity, because on the hidden units, multiple things are there. You say that you see that in the downstream, you want to find out the same quantity. Again, the same formula that you say that error, whether you are going to apply a chain rule. Chain rule that del net k upon net j, and here error with respect to the net k that we have talked a lot, and we have said that this is going to be delta j. So here I am telling that for all the k, so let me write it delta k, that is not a problem. Minus of delta k, this is the error, this is definition. By the definition into the previous slide it comes, what is this quantity? Net k upon net j. So this quantity, again we can apply a chain rule. We can say that net k upon oj and oj upon net j. Oj upon net j, we have also seen that it is again the sigmoid thing, that oj 1 minus oj is the sigmoid, again the sigmoid kind of thing. Here we have a special kind of arrangement, because you know that what is the net k. Net k is equal to wk 1 xk 1 dot dot dot. Okay, and what is the output of jth unit? Output of jth unit. So actually net k is equal to, you can say that net k is equal to wk 1, this multiplication. What is oj? Oj is the output of kth unit. So this is the output that is going to be input to the next unit, k xkj. Xkj, because what is the output? Whatever output is there into, when you are into the hidden layer, whatever output you are going to have, this is going to be the whatever output you are going to have, it is going to be input to the next layer. So if you see that what is the input, that is kj, so you can say that this oj is equal to kj. And if it is like that, then only this term survives, all other terms become zero. And here you are finding out the derivative with respect to this quantity. So what remains? Wkj. So here you have Wkj. This is oj 1 minus oj. This is delta k. So this quantity comes out to be that you can take it out OJ 1 minus OJ summation for all the k into the downstream then delta k WKJ. So this is the second formula where I'm going to call it delta J as a minus of ED upon net J. So again I can utilize this quantity into this how much I have to change, put into the formula, you got this particular equation. So this is the derivative actually. This is the derivative. I suggest you that you please go once again and visit this mathematical definition. So very simple, elegant proof that actually gives you that how to find out the parameter. So when you are going to update the parameter of a hidden layer, you need to find out what is there into the downstream. For all of them, you find out the weights and you multiply with their delta k's. And then there is a form, there is a representation by which you can find out how much I have to change. Now we are into the position that we can train up to two layers. Okay, this layers, I can find out the parameter over here. I can find out the parameter over here. What if one more layer I have? No problem. The same thing you can apply that if you want to find out this, this particular formula uses that things on the downstream. So the same formula would work. And then you can add over here and you can keep updating the parameters of whatever layers you have. Make sense? This graph is coming to you not the first time. Earlier also we have talked about that the last landscape is very difficult. If you initialize your weight in such a way so that you are into this particular location, you would be ultimately reaching to this particular position also only by doing the gradient descent. If you are here, for example, you may stuck somewhere here into the local minima itself. You are here, you can stuck into this particular position only. So most of the time people is stuck into the local minima. If you are here, then only you would be able to get the global minima. So landscape is very difficult. So finding out the right kind of initialization is an important thing to be done. Make sense? So there is a suggestion that sometimes people say that, for example, if you are here and you want to come to this particular place and you think that you are going to be stuck. So there is one suggestion that says that you use the previously updated value, some portion of previously updated value also to update the weights into this particular setting. This method is called the adding momentum. And the equation when you use the momentum is this, that you say that if you want to find out that how much I should change into this iteration, you see that how much you have used into the previous iteration. What was your, how much you have changed into the previous iteration, you apply some kind of alpha over there. And whatever you compute by using your equation that how much you should change into this particular direction, into this particular iteration, you use the previous value also into the current updation. What do I mean by this? That you want to update the weights is equal to W plus something delta W. But this delta W, if you write down that how much you have used previous things, right now you think that you have to add 0.1. But previously you have add 0.03. So some factor of that, maybe alpha time 0.03, you add to this particular quantity and use this thing to update your new value. This is called the adding momentum. And this is the same thing that when you have multiple layers, then if you want to find out the parameter over here, use the same formula and use to update those things over here. Okay, so a caveat that when you apply a backpropagation, it can give you result to some local minima only. It is not going to give lead you to the global minima. How to do that? We have to find out. Okay. No method are known that can tell that when this local minima would have give you a problem, because you would be able to optimize, but whether you would be able to find out the absolutely best parameter, that is not clear. As we have suggested that sometime you can use the momentum. Okay. And these things are not new for you. To any Boolean function can be represented by neural network and error is bounded. All these things are actually we know. Okay. When you are training, actually what happens that your error is something this initially. When you go to the next iteration, your error is going to reduce. We have talked it earlier also that initially the error falls with a steep gradient, but after that it does not fall with that gradient. So we can sometime utilize this particular portion, that is called what? Elbow point. And we can stop, means after that we don't want to train. However, it depends upon your requirement, that you, whether you want to continue the learning and reduce the error or not. So K-fold validation, everybody knows, I think, that sometime you can use the K-fold validation, and this is the stopping criteria that you can utilize to stop the training. We know if you don't do this, what is going to happen? That the training areas, however, the training areas you are able to reduce because of this parameter change, but on the testing, the error is going to increase if you're not stopping and you are keep learning. And this particular thing is called what? Overfitting. So therefore, you must stop at some particular point before. Otherwise, what would happen? That you would lead to the overfitting. Here is a coding example that has been taken from this particular source. I suggest everybody to please go to this particular place and on this particular website and see this particular nice representation. Very important data that it shows. It says that, let's assume that this is the data. Okay, this is the one class and here is the another class. You can see that they are very much aligned. If you use logistic regression or any regression methods, so regression methods also gives you a linear decision boundary only. So you would be only to able to separate using this particular hyperplane that separates the thing best. But you can see that in that particular case, these points are going to be misclassified if this is the line. So this particular blog actually says that I am going to use a neural network. And in this neural network, I am going to put the hidden layers. How many hidden layers? Let me tell you. When there is only one hidden layer, when there is only one hidden layer, then the neural network converges to this. When there are two hidden layers, then neural network converges to this. When there are three neurons into the hidden layer, then you converge to this particular thing. And you can see that this seems the best. So the size 3 is best. If you increase 4, it becomes better, but it looks like that now the things are getting overfitted. 5 with the 20, you get this kind of decision boundary. Okay, so having the 3 hidden layers is sufficient. That gives you a good data in this particular, for this particular problem. Okay, so the code is also available. You just see that you can run this code on your machine and try to see that what is the output and do some kind of interesting stuff with that. I will not go into that much detail, and because we have seen this into the last lab also. So you just go and find out the things from there. Thank you very much for the attention. So any questions, you are most welcome to ask.